This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
For more than 1,000 years, in the city of Athamiyah in the Iraqi capital, the mosque of Abu Hanifa Numan has opened its doors to the people of Baghdad as well as others. It has become an integral part of the history of Baghdad. After the U.S. occupation, the people of Athamiyah established a special cemetery inside the famous mosque. They called it the Cemetery of the Martyrs. They were also able to restore the operation of the mosque's clock, which was constructed 90 years ago.
الأعظمية مدينة تنتمي إلى فقيه وتأخذ اسمها من اسمه إنه الإمام
الأعظمية is a city that belonged to a jurisprudent and was named after him, the great Imam Abu Hanifa al-Numan, a scientist whose knowledge reached brilliance and who established a school of thought that extended across the far corners of the Islamic world. This mosque is more than 1,000 years old. With the days, this landmark of gathering became an authentic part of Baghdad's history. The Mosque of Abu Hanifa witnessed battles on the day of the fall. The bombs of the occupier prevented the Friday prayer from taking place for the first and only time. TV stations then raced to document the next Friday prayer in this mosque, which is considered one of the oldest and most honored mosques in Iraq.
وسقطت أمريكا التي نعرفها.
The America that we know fell. This is not the America that we know.
يمثل جامع أبو حنيفة صورة للتعايش المذهبي في العراق.
The Mosque of Abu Hanifa represents an image of intersectarian coexistence in Iraq. The mosque stands in front of the mosque of Imam Musa al-Kathim. This duality was born within this place and provided shade for the whole society.
عندما أمر القائمون على أمر الدولة العراقية
But the days after the occupation seem to have stopped the story of history in place. Those in charge of Iraqi affairs after the occupation closed off the Ayma Bridge, which connected the two areas and the tombs of the two imams. The Numan Mosque has several unique characteristics. The most important is the mosque cemetery, known as the Cemetery of the Martyrs. This cemetery keeps expanding by the day. Everyone who was killed at the hands of the occupation forces or by deceptive acts is buried in this place. Groups and groups of martyrs have come here to retell the woes of Iraq. The people of Athamiyah restored their mosque after the U.S. bombs caused damage, particularly the clock of the great imam. The clock was manufactured by an Iraqi architect about 90 years ago. The cycle of life and the succession of generations has to continue. These images were taken from inside the clock tower. The architect built it with the condition that all its parts and materials be from Iraq. The houses of Athamiyah surround the mosque of Abu Hanifa. The houses show signs of sadness over the events. Beneath the soil of Baghdad is holiness and science, but when will this be seen shining upon the horizon?
During a conference about the history of Yemen in Al Hudaydah town on the Red Sea coast, President Ali Abdullah Saleh vowed that the security forces will pursue the terrorists even in their homes and bring them to justice. Saleh also said that security agencies have made accomplishments on this level, explaining the Yemeni authorities can't stop those who decide to kill themselves. He was referring to the suicide bombers.
The attack against the foreigners is not actually an attack against the foreigners. It's an attack against our homeland. It is against the dignity of our homeland and the sovereignty of our homeland. This attack is condemned and rejected. I promise you, and I promise all citizens, God willing, we will pursue the perpetrators, even in their homes and hideouts, until we arrest them and bring them to justice. The attack against the American embassy is an attack against our homeland. The actions of those who hold banners saying death to Americans and Israelis are also against the homeland. They want evil for this homeland.
نشد أهالي ناحية الهاشميات في محافظة بابل الحكومة.
The residents of Al-Hashimiyah in the province of Babel urged the government to intervene by providing solutions for the lack of drinking water in their areas, where the highest numbers of cholera cases have been recorded. The provisional council members criticize what they call censorship by the Ministry of Health towards what is happening in the province. More details with Iman Muhammad.
إيمان محمد والتفاصيل.
Officials from the Ministry of Health believe that the lack of drinking water in the province of Babel is the reason behind the spread of cholera there. The residents of Al-Hashimiyah, where the largest number of cholera cases have been recorded, complained about what they called media censorship and demanded that the spread of cholera be reported so all people would know about it. They also feel that the government has been ignoring them, and they reject that.
We have cases of cholera in the village of Al-Ghazala in Al-Matathiyah and in the village of Rateb. Two people died and three are in hospital. Our village is small. As you see, we do not have anything. We do not have water. The government does not do anything for us. They should find a solution for us. This is not right. The government must come and see what is happening. We have dug, but there is no water, not even in the wells.
We urge Iraqi officials and the Minister of Health, who is sitting in his air-conditioned office, to help us. He should come and see the drinking water that we have. It is not even good enough for dogs.
The Babel Council said that the health conditions in Babel are very dangerous and that cholera has spread to larger geographical areas. They criticized the censorship of the health department in Babel.
It is strange because cholera has spread in the province of Babel. The disease has spread from the southern part to the northern part of the province. Deaths were recorded in hospitals in the northern part of the province, particularly in Al-Musayyib Hospital. Government support is very limited, and the response of the Ministry of Health has been insufficient.
The health department in Babel and the health ministry have denied the spread of cholera, although official statistics based on hospital records show that the number of cholera cases have increased. We have 134 cholera cases in the hospital of Margan, 267 cases in the Walada hospital, and 61 cases in the Al-Jarahi Hospital, which is the main hospital in the province.
Officials from the Ministry of Health made their first visit to the Babel province after the disease spread. According to the Ministry of Health, 20 cases of cholera have been documented in the entire province. However, officials from the province said that the hospitals received 1,300 cases with symptoms of cholera.
Are there cases of diarrhea in the province of Babel? Yes, but not all diarrhea cases are caused by cholera.
Officials in the central government tried to undermine the seriousness of the cholera disease in the province of Babel. Some believe that the government was politically motivated. However, officials in the province confirm that the cholera has spread in their province. In the meantime, the residents of Babel, especially the children, are dying one after the other. From the province of Babel, Iman Muhammad, Al Samaria.
Well, it's been 2 days since her razor-thin victory in the Kadima primaries, and Tzipi Livni has begun the task of unifying her party's ranks behind her. Livni this morning convened the Kadima Party faction at its Pirak Tikva headquarters, but her efforts failed to go smoothly, and the meeting was marred by boycotts and protests from supporters of Transportation Minister Shaul Mufaz, who yesterday announced his decision to quit politics. Mufaz refused Livni's request to meet and chose not to attend today's meeting, which was also boycotted by Mufaz supporter M.K. Zaev Elkin, who said, quote, "This is not the proper time for a victory party or a fake display of unity." Livni meanwhile urged party members to put the primary campaign behind them, saying, quote, "Yesterday's rivalry has ended, and there will be no divisiveness within Kadima." Pledging to help Livni in every way possible, Kadima leadership candidates Mayor Shitrit, Avi Dichter, and the remainder of the faction have reportedly united under Livni's leadership. The new Kadima party chief also announced her plans this morning to meet with factions that are not a part of the current government in order to broaden the coalition base. Livni met with Shas chairman Eli Yishai yesterday to see if his party will agree to be part of the coalition.
Shas should join the government, the sooner the better. I think that there is no need for new coalition negotiation. The government guidelines are intact. All they need to do is to support the prime minister, the new prime minister-elect, Livni, and the government should function the way it did for a long time.
قالت منظمة حقوق الإنسان الإسرائيلية بيت سالم إن سلطات الاحتلال.
The Israeli Human Rights Organization Beit Salem reported that the Israeli occupation and settlers have taken over large areas of the West Bank territories. These areas were annexed to settlements east of the separation wall.
كشفت منظمة بيت سالم أن سلطات الاحتلال الإسرائيلي والمستوطنين قد نهبوا في السنوات الأربع الأخيرة.
The Israeli Human Rights Organization Beit Salem also revealed that the Israeli occupation and settlers have robbed tens of thousands of dunams east of the wall to enlarge their settlements.
لقضية منع وصول الفلسطينيين إلى أراضيهم الواقعة حول المستوطنات.
Beit Salem devoted its news reports to defend human rights in the Palestinian territories, particularly the plight of Palestinians who can no longer reach their land located near Israeli settlements. The report titled The Stolen Land revealed the occupation and the settlers have annexed tens of thousands of dunams to their settlements east of the separation wall. According to the reports, the confiscation of land is done in several ways. The settlers and occupation forces carry out violent attacks against the Palestinians with the objective of forcing them to leave their lands near Israeli settlements. The other way that is used to rob people of their land is through the construction of the wall and land barriers, not to mention the electronic devices that were placed around every settlement, designed to prevent the Palestinians from reaching their lands, which eventually are confiscated. So far, 12 Israeli settlements east of the separation wall have claimed 450,000 dunams, half of which were owned by the Palestinians. These lands are used to expand the settlements and double their size. Beit Salem's report said the land near the settlements that are closed off mainly affects Palestinian farmers. The occupation authorities prevent these farmers from reaching and cultivating their land.
Bedouins living across the eastern desert of the West Bank suffer from harsh living conditions. They are forced to live a primitive way of life.
على خلاف الصورة السائدة حول البدو باعتبارهم شعب من المتنقلين في أرض لا.
The impression that the Bedouins are nomads moving around in a land without a people is wrong. Bedouins live in deprivation and face harsh living conditions.
ما زالت العشائر البدوية المهجرة من
The Bedouin families who were displaced from Beer Saba and Arad south of Palestine in 1948 and many others live across the eastern deserts of the West Bank. They live in wool tents like the rest of the Palestinian refugees, but they are different because human rights organizations can't seem to reach them until today.
طريقاً إلى مضارب البدو.
هناك بعض المشاكل بتواجههم من قبل الإسرائيليين وخاصة الاحتلال والمستوطنين.
They face some problems because the Israeli occupation and settlers prevent them from reaching the grazing land, and they confiscate it. Their farming homes are demolished. They're displaced every day.
Despite the difficult living conditions, poor terrain, and lack of services, the occupation adds to the Bedouins' suffering by demolishing the homes of many of them. The so-called Green Patrol units shoot and kill many Bedouin shepherds, making the lives of their families extremely difficult.
Our students can't go to school. Some students have to travel 10 kilometers back and forth. In addition to this, they are not safe from the settlers, even in their schools. In this area, we are surrounded by settlers.
About 30,000 Bedouins live here hoping that the coming days will help them live through the hot summers and cold winters. They hope for a better future and that some people will come to their aid to put these difficulties behind them.
هدد ناطق باسم جيش الأمة المتشدد والمقرب من تنظيم القاعدة في غزة بالقيام بعمليات عسكرية انتقامية كبيرة.
A spokesman for the Umma Army, an extremist organization in Gaza that is close to Al-Qaeda, threatened to carry out large military operations against the leadership of Hamas if it does not release their leader Abu Hafs al-Maqdisi. He was arrested by Hamas militias several days ago after the military parade that the organization held a while back. Syrian President Bashar al-Assad succeeded in breaking the grip of isolation from around the neck of his country. He regained a presence and an effectiveness in the world that Damascus has been missing for many years while the U.S. attack submerged the region. Damascus hosted the four-way meeting with Turkey, France, and Qatar. But in spite of this, al-Assad's feet remained firmly planted on the ground. He maintained his balance. He did not get swayed from the region's issues by the excitement of debating with the leaders of those nations. He remained aware that the French, in spite of their openness to Syria, will continue to favor Israel over the Arabs. The behavior of al-Assad is reminiscent of the March 14 coalition, who felt like they held the keys to the universe. They thought that they could change the fate of law and nations in their hands after they were given promises by the U.S. administration. However, the aware ones amidst them quickly realized that these promises were like sea foam. In an interview with Iranian TV, al-Assad demonstrated his country's position on the current issues.
Syrian President Bashar al-Assad said the strategic relationship between Syria and Iran has proved its importance for the region, especially in the last decade, after the victory of the resistance in Lebanon and the steadfastness of the resistance in Palestine after the Second Intifada, as well as the partial failure of the plan set for the region. In an interview with Iranian TV, al-Assad said that the French President Nicolas Sarkozy wants to regain a role for his country after Jacques Chirac's period, which canceled France's role outside of Europe. However, Syria deals with this situation realistically.
We do not expect the West in the near future to be closer to us than it is to Israel. This is for historical reasons related to the issue of Jews and so on. So, we did not expect that the European official would come to us and tell us, we are with you and with the rights of Arabs and Palestinians, and the other rights that belong to all these countries. But at the same time, we want to see the beginning of a distinction between the roles of Europe and the United States. This is what we are seeing in regards to dealing with the current issues. We want to see a European official say to us that we have the right to reclaim our land in its totality. They want to fight terror in all its forms, but they do not see Israeli terrorism.
Al-Assad likened the indirect Israeli-Syrian negotiations with negotiations that preceded the Madrid conference. He expressed a mistrust of the Israelis until they prove themselves otherwise.
As for what was presented in the media, saying that the indirect negotiations began by Syria moving away from the resistance or Syria moving away from Iran, that is incorrect. The reason is simple. The Israelis know very well where Syria is proceeding and how it is proceeding. We are not one of the nations that build temporary, transitional, or situational relations. We are a nation that has principles and interests. The relationship between Syria and Iran was not built through the peace process or the war process.
Al-Assad considered that the failure of the United States and its allies led them to play their final cards. They either have to win or they will lose everything. He expressed his belief that they will continue to lose.
Police in India have shot dead two men in a gun battle in the country's capital, Delhi. The fighting erupted around a house where police say five suspected Islamic militants had been hiding out. The city has been on edge just days after the bombings, which killed 22 people. From Delhi, Matt McClure reports.
Chaos reigns for over an hour. Police struggle to get civilians out of harm's way while a gun battle rages with suspects holed up in an apartment block in this middle-class Muslim neighborhood. When the firing finally ends, sure signs the battle has been bloody.
The special cell of Delhi police carried out the encounter here today. Firing took place and the elements fired, even the special cell team fired.
The bodies of the two dead men are rushed away in an ambulance. One of them, police say, was a leader of an Islamic militant group responsible for a spate of recent bombings that have rocked major Indian cities. The suspect that was arrested alive is led away for interrogation to the cheers of onlookers, some of whom are angry these men may have been living in their midst. It's wrong, says this man. The owners of this building should have verified who they were renting to. This raid comes less than a week after Delhi was hit by a series of bomb blasts in busy shopping areas that left 22 dead and more than 100 wounded. A little-known group called Indian Mujahideen claimed responsibility, as it had after other recent attacks in Ahmedabad and Jaipur. For India's embattled Home Minister, who oversaw today's clash from police headquarters, the raid was a demonstration that authorities can and will strike back. A show of strength that may reassure a country on edge and wondering whether the government is equipped to confront this threat and where the bombers might strike next. Matt McClure, Al Jazeera, Delhi.
The environment where Muslims live plays a role in helping or deterring them from fasting during Ramadan. The general atmosphere in the West is one of the challenges facing Muslims who want to observe their Islamic practices. However, in some cases, it creates a stronger motivation among Muslims to stay committed to their Islamic identity, especially during Ramadan. More details with Mohamed Wabousi from Paris.
France has more than 5 million Muslims. It is not surprising to see crowded mosques with worshippers praying outside during Ramadan, especially in Arab neighborhoods. Like the rest of Muslim families, this Arab family uses the month of Ramadan as an opportunity to strengthen their traditions, which they brought with them from their regional countries, as well as their Islamic identity.
The month of Ramadan is the month of repentance and forgiveness. We fast and read the Quran.
Despite their young age, these children begin fasting. They also compete in memorizing verses from the Holy Quran. For these family members, Ramadan is not an excuse to be lazy. In addition to refraining from eating and drinking, they have to exhibit positive behaviors.
There is a big difference since we live in a non-Muslim country, but we still try to maintain our traditions. We visit with our Moroccan, Tunisian, and Algerian neighbors, as well as all other Muslims.
Respect and adherence to the holy month of Ramadan has been increasing in France, especially when compared to the adherence of the four other Muslim pillars. According to a poll survey conducted by a French center, only 49% of France's Muslims go regularly to mosques, but 88% of them fast during Ramadan. There are complaints about the lack of observance of Ramadan in France, which is seen as a sign of political weakness by the French Muslim community. Although the number of Muslim Algerians is constantly increasing, and although Islam is the second religion after Christianity in France, their political influence is still less than other communities that are fewer in number. Muhammad Wabusi, Dubai Television, Paris.
Some Israeli officials have been threatening to strike Iran's nuclear facilities. Are these threats empty or loaded? Will Israel strike before the U.S. elections in November? And will there be an October surprise? Answers to these questions and more on Link TV's Mosaic Intelligence Report.
It's been several months since a war of words erupted between Iran and Israel, raising speculations that a possible Israeli strike on Iran's nuclear facilities, which the West and Israel suspect of enriching uranium for the purpose of making nuclear bombs, might be near. However, Iran's President Mahmoud Ahmadinejad recently played down this possibility, saying that Israel is in a weak position to launch attacks against any other country.
And those who speak of sanctions are demonstrating their helplessness and admitting to the strength of the Iranian nation.
Is Israel weak? Not according to many Israeli analysts who believe that an Israeli attack on Iranian nuclear sites looks unavoidable. This statement was also shared by Iranian-born former Defense Minister Shaul Mufaz, who said in an interview to Israel's largest newspaper, Yedioth Ahronot, "If Iran continues with its program for developing nuclear weapons, we will attack it. The sanctions are ineffective." He also said that Israel has the means and capabilities to succeed in such a mission. Just a short while ago, Israel's request for a fresh supply of GBU-28 bunker busters, each weighing 2 tons and capable of punching through reinforced concrete, was turned down by the Bush administration. Instead, the U.S. has agreed to sell 1,000 versions of a much smaller satellite-guided bomb capable of hitting underground targets. In addition, according to the Israeli newspaper Haaretz, the U.S. has refused to grant Israel safe passage through Iraqi airspace in order to target Iran's nuclear facilities. But according to Ronen Bergman, an Israeli investigative journalist and author of The Secret War with Iran, the Israeli Mossad estimates of what they term as the first Iranian nuclear device to be ready at the end of 2009 and the beginning of 2010. Meanwhile, the clock is ticking on the window of opportunity for an Israeli strike on Iran's nuclear facilities while George Bush is still in office. Many military experts believe that in order for such an operation to succeed, the United States must be on board and ready to confront any Iranian retaliation. One set of scenarios surfacing in the Israeli media is the prediction that Israel will strike Iran shortly after the U.S. presidential election in November, should Barack Obama be declared the winner. I, on the other hand, see it differently. If Israel decides to strike Iran, what stops it from pulling off an October surprise? Here is the scenario. Israel attacks Iran sometime in October with or without the blessings of the Bush administration. Iran responds, and the United States feel compelled to assist Israel to prevent a worse scenario of what happened to Israeli towns during the war on Lebanon in 2006 when Hezbollah retaliated with barrages of rockets. Americans will quickly forget about the economy and look for a war president. John McCain wins in November. I'm Jamal Dajani for the Mosaic Intelligence Report. And for all of you out there, Mosaic fans and supporters, I have great news for you. With your help, we have reached our goal of raising $200,000. Yes, you did it, and we're grateful to you. Thank you.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic video podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you. This program was brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. television network devoted to global and national news with uncompromising documentaries and diverse cultural programs. Programs which connect you to the world.